everyone. If you could please scoot to the center and to the side so that everyone can join us. We are expecting a full house today. Thank you. To the center and to the side, please.
Thank you. Okay, welcome everyone. We've been waiting for some latecomers to move in, and most people are now inside, so that's great. Glad to have you here tonight. We have a wonderful speaker, wonderful topic, set of topics really, so that'll be fun. But I want to tell you about something else first. We're going to do a little flying around, because some of you come here and you know about some part of our institution, but not the other parts. And those of you came here through an interest in biology tonight may not know about some of our astronomy. So I'm going to show you a little bit of our astronomy, some of the work in progress, not the actual science itself, but some of our facilities in Chile. Could we go to the movie, Michael? So I made a little movie of our facilities in Chile. The biggest telescopes there, these two, were constructed, maybe have the lights down a little, under the leadership of Maxine Singer, a former president of Carnegie. These are called the Magellan Telescopes. We have a hotel complex. We own about 60,000 acres in the northern part of Chile in the Atacama Desert. And these two telescopes are used virtually every night for research by astronomers from all over the world, but especially by our own astronomers who use about half the nights available on these two amazing telescopes. Meanwhile, we're plotting the next generation in partnership with 10 other institutions on that far hill over there, which has been flattened. The giant Magellan Telescope, as mentioned here on that flattened spot. Those towers are 50 meters high. The giant Magellan Telescope, which you saw in that artist's rendering a moment ago, will be 60 meters high, and about the mirror array, about 24 and a half meters in diameter. It'll have 100 times the sensitivity of Hubble and 10 times the resolution of Hubble, and will allow astronomers to see things that no one has ever seen before, things that we are looking for, like exoplanets, and things we don't yet know enough to look for, and that's the fun of it. The support buildings for that giant telescope will be in this bowl over here. They're being excavated now. And we're very excited having in proximity our existing telescopes, which will be very important and powerful tools for many decades to come, and these new neighbors with this incredible machine 20 stories high. 20 stories high and the building has to turn around. We had a bloom of the desert this year, as sometimes happens in Death Valley, with some rain and snow. And the desert was covered with purple flowers. I missed that, unfortunately. But what's there now, this is from about 2 weeks ago, are a zillion field mice that have also bloomed. And as a result, a lot of hawks are turning up. So you're about to go inside the left-hand telescope, not with a drone in this case, just with a tripod, and look at the telescope poking around. Now, this was still in the daytime, so the dome is closed to protect the mirror. The mirror is 6.5 meters in diameter and polished to 10 nanometer precision to get really sharp images of the universe out there. And this is used by teams of astronomers. We have a staff of about 70 people who work at this place called Las Campanas Observatory. They work in two shifts and take turns, and they keep this thing running extremely well. In fact, it operates 91% of the nights, and of the remaining 9%, 8% is due to weather and 1% to downtime. So that's an incredible record of fine management of a very complex set of machines. This is some of our team members from down there, along with some visiting astronomers, photographers, various leaders. Here you see sunset approaching as you approach, and you'll see the telescopes opening up in a moment to spend their night hard at work. It is a strange world there. When you visit there, there's lots to see during the day, but then of course everybody's staying up all night, so you don't get any sleep at all, but it's worth it because the night sky is so unbelievable. Everyone does the same thing. They step outside for the first time there and cannot believe what they're seeing. That left-hand scope is open. This one's still closed. They open, there's the open one. And of course, these are looking at the southern hemisphere, which my perhaps biased astronomer friends tell me is better than the Northern Hemisphere. One of the reasons it's better is that you can see the Magellanic Clouds, which are nearby galaxies of particular interest. There are other excuses they use, but the fact is both skies are pretty fantastic. There's one of the Magellanic Clouds up there, and this is the kind of thing you see at night. So this is boys with their toys. This is me playing with a drone, but I thought I'd use the occasion to show you a little bit about our telescope facilities down there. So that's a wonderful place and a wonderful kind of science, exploring the unknown, which is what all of our scientists do. We have a department of plant biology on the Stanford campus, and one of the people who emerged from that is our speaker tonight. Now, I want to lead up to that. I'll show you a few artist conceptions of this, this telescope first. Let's turn to the next slide. Oh, I guess I can do that. Here we go. So this gives you some idea of the size of a giant telescope. This is one of the seven mirrors just made this past fall. It's a 20 tons of glass and an 8.4 meter mirror. This is the central mirror, so it has a hole through it so the instruments can see the light that's focused by the telescope. And you can see it's a fairly large thing. It has 20 tons of glass in it, even though it's a honeycomb. Really incredible thing, and it will be polished for about the next 5 years to bring it to spec, and then put on a truck and a ship and a truck to get it to the top of the mountaintop, as you just saw, and incorporate it into that kind of structure with the other mirrors. So this is going to be, I think, a technical wonder of the world. It's a partnership with the University of Arizona, where the mirrors are made, with Harvard, Smithsonian, University of Chicago, two Texas universities, Brazil, Korea, Australia, universities all over. At the moment, there's no federal funding from the US in this, which, depending on how you look at it, is a sad reflection on a lack of support of science, or a way of gaining some freedom from government regulations. There are elements of both kinds of satisfaction, I suppose. So this thing will be quite an amazing thing. It's going to take probably 10 years to build, but maybe operating in sort of partial form with some of the mirrors before it's completely finished. Okay, so we go in Carnegie, this wonderful span of things, we go from cosmology and astronomy all the way across to ecology, with most of the things you might imagine are in between. And today we're going to talk about closer to ecology, the plant science and molecular genetics of plants and so on, these fantastic things. So now I want to tell you an introduction of our speaker by first celebrating plants themselves. So without doubt, we're utterly dependent on plants. They provide the oxygen we breathe, the fuel that warms us, much of the food we eat, even the coffee that wakes us up in the morning. Plants clean up pollution, they give us medicine, we use them to stop erosion and combat climate change, and you'll hear more about that later. They inspire our art and technology. The ribs of the giant water lily inspired the great crystal palace of Victorian England. The seed pods of cocklebur inspired the invention of Velcro. And all of us who have pulled burrs off our pants wish we had thought of that, because we'd be very rich. And the ultimate signature of plants, photosynthesis, continues to inspire our efforts to develop solar cells. Though their lives are intimately entwined with ours, for thousands of years, plants were placed kind of at the bottom of the biological hierarchy, thought to lack the complexity, movement, and senses of animals. Until relatively recently, there were few scientists who studied plants to learn about plants, and not just how they might serve us as sources of medicine or food or decoration. Charles Darwin was actually one of the first. He spent the last half of his life observing plants, documenting how they move and how they respond to their environments. His greenhouse at Downhouse, still there, was full of carnivorous plants and still is. He loved them. He even speculated in the late 1800s that the very tips of roots were brain-like organs, that they had the power to direct movements of the stems and leaves. These ideas were widely and to some extent prematurely rejected. Such was the state of plant biology when, in the early part of the 20th century, the Carnegie Institution, our science institution, founded a department devoted to the study of plants. Located in Tucson, Arizona, the buildings are still there. The Desert Botanical Laboratory, as it was called, pioneered investigations of desert ecology, focusing on how plants adapt to drought and heat stresses. That is still a topic of great interest to our scientists today, especially these days, some of us living in California, it's very much on our minds. Our present Department of Plant Biology in Stanford has been at the forefront of studies of plant physiology, genetics, development, molecular biology, showing us time and again that plants are every bit as complex as animals, just not in the same ways. Plants sense their environments, have complex regulatory pathways, and have evolved sophisticated adaptive structures. They mount defenses when under siege, communicate with their neighbors, and even practice mimicry and deceit. They're politicians. They synthesize chemicals that make caterpillars molt prematurely and others that alter behaviors of animal predators and the workings of human brains. Some of them contribute to and in some sense control human ritual. They can form vast underground networks and ecosystems. They can convert, with the help of collaborating bacteria, massive amounts of nitrogen from the air into nutrients, and they can produce heat to melt away snow. Some of them eat animals, even rats, for lunch. They entrain insects for sex. Individual plants can live for thousands of years. Now up here you see a ginkgo tree, leaves and trees, ginkgo trees, and I'm wearing a tie that has ginkgo leaves on it. This is a living fossil in that similar plants existed 270 million years ago. Ginkgo trees were found in 1896 to have motile sperm that swim toward the egg using multiple flagella. Mosses and ferns do the same, but this is a tree. Okay, so let's look at a clip here on YouTube celebrating the discovery of a Japanese scientist in 1896 showing these are sperm of a plant swimming toward the egg. Plants and animals aren't as far apart as you might have thought. It's probably not too rash to say that organisms in the plant kingdom, in fact, have the most diverse biochemistry, reproductive strategies, and life histories of any organisms on Earth, perhaps discounting the microbial world. Flowering plants alone comprise some 300,000 species, compared with fewer than 5,000 species of mammals. We have not exhausted what plants can tell us, both about themselves and about ourselves. As our guest tonight, Dr. Dominique Bergmann, will tell us, the genes of plants and animals are also not as different as they might seem. Dr. Bergmann is an associate professor in the Department of Biological Sciences at Stanford University, where she studies cell fate, stem cell renewal, and cell polarity. She earned her bachelor's from the University of California at Berkeley, and her PhD at the University of Colorado in Denver. She began her career studying developmental asymmetry using genes in worm embryos. Asymmetry, where a single cell, notably a stem cell, gives rise to two different daughter cells, typically one daughter cell that's like the parent and one that's different, is a key part of development in all organisms. When Dr. Bergmann joined Chris Somerville's lab at Carnegie's Department of Plant Biology, on the Stanford campus as a postdoc fellow, she switched to plants, finding that the stem cells giving rise to stomata, the breathing pores of leaves, in the little mustard plant Arabidopsis, offered an ideal system for understanding asymmetry in development. So she was studying fundamental questions that apply to all of developmental biology, plants and animals. She moved to Stanford in 2005, Since 2011, she has also been a Howard Hughes Medical Institute and Betty Moore Foundation investigator. She's an associate of the Stanford Institute for Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine, and she remains associated with our Department of Plant Biology, that is the Carnegie Department, as an adjunct staff member. In 2010, she received the American Society of Plant Biology's Charles Albert Schulz Award, and in 2011, a Presidential Early Career Award in Science and Engineering. In that same year, she was identified as a scientist to watch by The Scientist magazine. She has indeed been a scientist to watch. I'm a developmental biologist. I've certainly paid attention to her work. It's fascinating. She has made many fundamental discoveries about the molecular forces that guide development, and her current work with plant stem cells and the long lifespans they promote promises to help us understand our own biological potential. So please welcome Dominique Bergmann.
Thank you, Matt, for that really generous and wonderful invitation. And I want to thank all of you for being here on this evening so we can talk about plants and some of the hidden things that they might reveal to us. So here I've got some images. After this movie in the beginning, I'm used to looking up and skyward and out. Here we're going to be looking inward to the secrets of plants. Now, my first slide is actually it's somewhat stolen from Matt's talk a little while ago. So one of the things that's wonderful about preparing for a talk like this, although I have to admit it's fairly nerve-wracking to have a talk like this, one of the wonderful things about preparing for it is that you go back and you look at all the other science lectures that Carnegie has online. And I would say that Matt Scott's is brilliant. You should watch it at least twice. But one of the things that he did in the beginning, and he was trying to make a contrast between the geological world, the stable, never-changing Earth, and the dynamics of biology, so the fast-moving things that we see. And when I looked at this slide, I thought, this is actually a perfect slide to introduce something about plants, because plants, they surround us, we live among them, they're amazing creatures, we depend on them, and yet sometimes we forget about them. So in this image, it's supposed to represent how we have the unchanging Earth. You might see El Capitan, part of Yosemite. You might see a big rock. I see trees. I see lots of biology, Matt. And you're right, it might not be running around and it might not be squawking at us, but it's there for the long haul. And we should be incredibly happy that it is there for the long haul because we really depend on it. So what do I mean by the long haul? Well, plants can live for thousands of years. So this is a bristlecone pine. This is in the mountains in California. And this is more than 5,000 years old. So imagine this. These are creatures that are continually living. They're continually renewing themselves. They're not getting cancer. How are they doing this? They're doing this in concert with nature. They're doing this in response to the environment that they see around them. And in over 5,000 years, the environment changes a lot. So these are incredibly adapted. And they're really, how is it that they do this? This completely fascinates me. So I was pretty impressed. I was actually looking for the oldest living thing. And so I thought this was going to win, but actually I was wrong. There's another tree. This is in Scandinavia. And this spruce tree is apparently 9,000 years old. Now, to me, this looks a little bit younger than this one. And so the reason for that is that this is a single organism. This is part of a clone. So you know what that means? Not only can they live along, trees can clone themselves. So that's pretty amazing. So they can live for a very long time, and they have the capacity to regenerate themselves. So what can we learn from the way they do that? So the other thing that's pretty remarkable about plants, so I'm very impressed by this longevity. The other thing we shouldn't forget is that we are only here on this Earth because they were there first. So this is a cartoon from probably what you all had in fifth grade, and I had the same thing, where we learned about primary productivity. So plants are taking light energy from the sun and carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and they're turning it into that into sugars, and that's what we eat, and that's what animals eat, and this is driving some cycles. They're also taking water up from the soil through their roots and bringing it up to the air. So they're an essential part of creating the atmosphere that we have right now with lots of oxygen in it, and they're creating food for us. So we're really dependent on these guys. Okay, so when I was thinking about this, and I was thinking about how do we think about plants, we can have sort of the utopian optimistic view of plants and think of them as these gentle giants, these aged souls that have lived for a very long time on Earth and can teach us some secrets. And in that case, this is what I'll tell you about stem cells and regeneration. But the other thing is we can think, and Matt's introduction also brought this up, that plants, they hold our existence in their hands. If they stop working, we die. So that's by this process of putting oxygen into the air and giving us food. But at the same time, plants are also actively trying to kill us by creating things like caffeine and other things like that. So, okay, so I'm going to talk for a few minutes at the end about the stem cells that we work on, their particular type of stem cells, and they create these breathing pores called stomata, and how this thing is related to global climate cycles, and a little bit of warning about how we should treat plants nicely for our own benefit. Okay. So let me talk about stem cells and introduce them in general about stem cells. One thing I have to say in the beginning is when I say stem cells, we're not talking about these. Those are stems, yes, but that's not the stem cells I'm talking about. The stem cells that I'm talking about are the things that regenerate. So we have them as well as plants, and I'm going to introduce them as this very, very generic cell, this purple cell. And the idea of the stem cell is that it's a cell that divides. It creates two different cells. One of those cells acts just like mom, so it's regenerating itself. That's the stem cell part. And the other cell goes off and does something different. So it gets spikes or something like that. So what we have here at the core of a stem cell is an asymmetric cell division. It's a cell division that creates two cells that are different, one just like mom and one that's new. So it's an asymmetric stem cell division. So we see these, so when we think about stem cells and we think about our own stem cells, these are things that we see in the embryo, and we see them later in life. So we have to remember that whether you're a plant or whether you're an animal, everyone started off with sort of the ultimate stem cell, that fertilized egg. That fertilized egg had the capacity, had the information in it to make all of the different complex and fascinating cells in your body, and also had the information to put them in the right places. So this is a very, very, this is totipotent. It can make everything. So the earlier we are in development, the more capacity we have. But as we move into later development, things get a little bit more restricted. So if we start at the beginning, there's the egg that can make everything. There are embryonic stem cells. So once the egg is fertilized, it will develop into an embryo, and the embryo will make a number of cells, all of which those cells all have the capacity to make many different cell types. So this is pluripotent; can make many different cell types. And then as we progress a little bit further and we look at what we're interested in when we talk about regenerative medicine or we're looking at, you know, my bad elbow or something like this, we're thinking about somatic or adult stem cells. So again, all of these cells are ones that are dividing, recreating themselves, and making something new. But these adult stem cells are more limited. So they can't make every cell in the body. They'll just make some. So there are stem cells in your skin that are regenerating your skin. There are stem cells in your liver that are regenerating your liver. Muscle that only make muscle. All right, so those are the natural stem cells. So those are the ones that you're born with and they last throughout your life. Plants have similar ones. About 10 years ago, there was a revolution that swept out commitment and development. So one idea was you start with the ability to be everything, and then as development proceeds, you become more and more restricted in what you can do. So a liver cell could never make anything else. And this thing called induced pluripotent cells really changed that. Because what they did was they took cells that were already a specific cell type. They were already they already made skin, or they already made something else, and they switched them into a different type of cell. Okay, so this said that you weren't stuck with your identity. And the way that you did that was take those cells and put them in a dish, take them out of the organism, give them a lot of factors, change things a lot, wait a few weeks, and then you could get a lot of these different stem cells. So that was telling us a little bit, there's a lot of pharmaceutical companies that are interested in this, a lot of biotech companies. But these cells are in a dish. And even though they're making muscle cells or they're making nerve cells, they're still in a dish. They're still not making a complex organism. And so while this has been happening, a number of people have taken a different approach, and that is to say, you know, we're not particularly good at regenerating ourselves, but if you look out in nature, there are lots of organisms that are much better than us. So let's figure out what they're doing and try to follow them. How are they set up? So we can have things like these embryonic stem cells, and this is from the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine. So this is a cell in a dish. But we can look to nature, and many people have looked at things like amphibians. So if you chop off the tail of a salamander, it'll grow back. If you chop off the arm of a frog, that will be a stump, but then it'll grow back. And not only does it create all of the different cell types in an arm, but it actually creates an arm. It's got little fingers. So that's something that we're very interested in doing. So things like amphibians have been used. This is work that was actually begun at the Carnegie Embryology, where planaria, little flatworms, you can cut them up into a whole bunch of pieces, and each one of those pieces will regenerate a whole. So you cut off a head, and it'll grow a whole flatworm. You cut off the tail, and that'll grow another one. So how that regenerates itself has been really interesting. So this is kind of going on in the field, and what I'd like to say is I think we need to add plants to this mixture, because plants are really good at making stem cells. So, you know, we have these models, and whenever you work on something, so if you're interested in how the human body works, why work on a plant? You know, this is a question that I get asked a lot, usually by grant panels. So why should you study stem cells in plants? And the first answer is they make really, really, really good stem cells. So they're excellent at it. There are also some practical reasons in that, you'll see some examples of these, that plants make stem cells in ways that we can actually study them. So they make them out on the surface, and we can watch them. We can watch the birth of a stem cell and its entire life, as well as its demise. And then there are two other things that I think are important, and one has to do with an evolutionary history. And I'll give you some more about this as well, but plants and animals are actually pretty different. And so it's a way of asking, if two different things come up with the same solution, there's something fundamental about that. If two things come up with a different solution to this problem of being a stem cell, then maybe we have an alternative if ours fails. And then the final thing, and I'm going to talk about this for a few minutes at the end, is that we are very focused on understanding stem cells for our own sake, but plant stem cells actually make important products for plants, and those are actually pretty important for the world. All right, so plant stem cells. Since the term stem has been already used to be the stem of a plant, we have a different name for stem cells in plants, and that's a meristem. Okay, so this is a plant embryo. It doesn't normally glow, but Stuart Gilmore put something in there so that it glows. So if you were to take a seed and take the seed coat off, this is what you'd see. And so this embryo has two different places where it has its stem cells. It's got at the top of the shoot, the apical meristem, and at the root, another pool. And these are pluripotent. They make lots of different types of cells. And so when you look at this after you've planted that seed and look out at nature, you can see that all of the things above ground will be made from here, and all of the things below ground will be made from here. Okay, so these are pluripotent and very powerful stem cells. They're also really beautiful to look at. So this is a view. This is from Adrienne Roeder when she was in Elliot Meyerowitz's lab. And if you were to take this little embryo and wait till it grows up a bit more, and then look down the top of it. So imagine you're looking at a head of broccoli and looking down the center of it. And in the center there, those are the stem cells. And they keep dividing. They keep dividing asymmetrically. They save one of themselves. They move something else out. And that actually helps them create all of these flowers that you see in a whorl. Okay, so those stem cells are a lot like the embryonic stem cells. They can make lots of different cell types and pretty complex structures. Now, what about the adult stem cells from humans? A more equivalent thing would be something that's not a meristem, but a meristemoid, so a little meristem. And these are things that make only a few cell types. And the one that I'm going to be talking about is on the leaf. And it's a stem cell lineage that only makes two cell types. It's in the epidermis. It makes these pavement cells, which interdigitate, and they help keep the plant waterproof so it doesn't rain in on the plant. But it also makes these little structures called stomata. And stomata are pores. They're pores from which carbon dioxide from the atmosphere gets into the plant, and water and oxygen leave the plant. Okay, so this is to remind me. Another important, so these are pretty important cells. But one of the things that's really useful about them is they are on the surface of the plant. You can watch them develop. And one of the things that always fascinated me with is, how does something get to be a stem cell in the first place? Where does that happen? And if we look at that in a mammal, the stem cells are actually formed when the embryo is still developing and when it's in utero. And so these are fairly inaccessible in terms of doing experiments. But these are right out there on the open, and we can really watch their entire development. Okay, so the other thing that I wanted to say, so this is kind of about how good their stem cells are. So I've talked about stem cells in plants, and they can make lots of different things, and meristemoids, they can make a few things. But really, pretty much any cell in a plant has some capacity to make any other cell. And so I showed you this already, this iPS cell, where the medical field was just flabbergasted by the fact that you could switch one cell from one type to another. I have to say, in the plant community, we're quite as impressed. And that's because, for us, regenerating, recreating a cell, recreating an entire organism, is essentially equivalent to a rainy day afternoon activity for a five-year-old. So you stick a potato in some water, you stick some other things in some water, and you grow a plant. Okay, so these are set, the tuning between differentiation and regeneration is set in a really different place in plants, and we'd love to know how that's set up. All right, so they've got good stem cells. Let me talk a little bit about this sort of view from another organism. So this is a somewhat modified tree of life. It's missing a few branches. But we have some animals over here, dinosaur, monkey. And we have some plants over here. And the accurate part, at least, of this diagram is that the last time that plants and animals shared something in common, they were a single-cell blob. Right? So everything about being multicellular, everything about development, everything about being stem cells, plants and animals had to invent that separately. And that's a really interesting perspective, because if everything is invented separately, or has the potential to be invented, if they invented exactly the same thing, that might tell us that's really the only way to do it. And so when we compare things, and I'm shamelessly using my nieces for these, we compare super cute little us versus plants, if we use the same genes, if we use the same mechanisms to accomplish the same goals, that means that there's probably really only one way to do that in nature. Whereas if they're very different solutions, then it tells us we've got some flexibility. And so practically speaking, we can think about, if we find that animals and plants are really doing the same things, that when we think about why plant stem cells are so much better than ours, we're not talking about having to reinvent something totally new. We just have to tune ours a little bit more so they're a little bit more like the plant ones. Whereas if plants and animals are completely different, then we have some possibility that if our system fails, from an engineering perspective, we could hijack theirs and see if we can put that on top. All right, so I'm going to get into some of the work that we do in our lab. And this is focused on stem cells, and it's focused specifically on these stomatal cells. So I mentioned this before, the stomata are breathing pores, and it's how we get carbon dioxide in and water and oxygen out. And so this is really essential for the plant. If the plant doesn't have stomata, it's dead. So it won't, if it can't breathe, basically that's the end of your life. So it's really critical to be able to make these. What I think is really cool about them is that they're made, so this end product that's important is made through this stem cell-like lineage, and we can watch all of it. So every time a plant makes a leaf, so all of our embryo, all of our development, all the interesting stuff happens when we're in utero. Like, we make arms and legs and heads, that all happens when we're really young. After we're born, we just kind of grow, right? Not so interesting. There's some interesting things, but plants, you know, that little tiny embryo you saw had two leaves. And when you see a tree, it's much, much more complex. So all of that is happening when this is out in the environment, and all of it is happening when we can watch it. So when we look at a little tiny leaf, this is an image just looking at the outlines of the cells in the leaf. There's not much going on there. But when the stem cell is born on this leaf, we see an asymmetric cell division. So back to those asymmetric cell divisions, a cell that makes two different types of cells. In this case, one's big and one's little, and one's green and one's white. So this is how you initiate it. Once you initiate it, the plant gets to do all sorts of funky things with these stem cells. So once you're a stem cell, you get to repeat that, so you can do that again. Sometimes the other cell gets to go back and be like grandma and go through here. I won't go through the excruciating details of this, but essentially there's a period that once you're a stem cell, you and your children get to be stem cells again. And this is actually helping you to build this organ, build this leaf. So the number of times you go through this, the bigger that your leaf is going to be. And you can make a choice as to whether you go this direction or this direction, and it's going to change the types of cells that you make. So you make more green cells if you go this way, you make more white cells if you go this way. So we call this amplification, somewhat similar to something called transit amplification in animals, but we take a few starting points and we can create a really big lineage. So that happens for some amount of time. They kind of, one cell does both of these things, and then something happens. Then some other switch is set. You've done enough. Your life as a stem cell is now over. You now need to go on to something else. So after this cell will stop, it'll turn blue, and then either go down this pathway to make those guard cells, those stomatal guard cells, or make these pavement cells. Okay, so I've shown this to you in a nice cartoon and in a line. I want you to look at it in real life. So I might need the lights down on this a little bit. This is a still image and a leaf. The green things, it's always going to be color-coded the same way, so the green things are the stem cells, and you'll notice that they're kind of all over the place. Blue cells are kind of all over the place. So this is what it looks like in a still image. I'm going to show you a movie, and then I'm going to show you another movie. So in the first movie, we're going to watch this. It takes about 24 hours. You can watch those green dots kind of bounce around. Hopefully you can see that with the light on it. The overall take-home view of this is that green things bounce around a little bit. Okay, so stem cells are there. They're not in one place, but they keep dividing. This is actually making the leaf grow. So what you're seeing here, plants don't move, right? What you're seeing when it looks like it's moving is actually growth. Okay, so now we're going to zoom in so you can see it a little bit better. And we're going to watch a couple of cells. So again, green are stem cells. You watch those divide and become other things. This is going to loop around a couple of times so you can watch it. So here is a cell that's already made it to the end of that lineage, has become the stomata. These other cells are on their way. So when they were green, everyone's a stem cell, and then they switch. And so watch this cell over here. When the movie loops around, you'll see it's green, so it's a stem cell. Now, there's two stem cells. They fight it out. One of them will win, and it gets to turn blue. The other one won't. So this is, you're actually watching the end of the life of the stem cells. It's deciding to move on to be that blue cell. Some of the other stem cells are still going on here. Okay, so this is what we observe. What's nice is this is all happening on the surface of the plant, and so we can watch those stem cells being born, living out their life, and then ending their lives. So we'd like to know kind of what's happening there. What is that green ball that you're seeing? It's actually the nucleus of the cell. The outlines of the cell here are in red. What's going on there? So one of the things that I just wanted to mention, this is really cool about plants, and a lot of people, I never thought about this till I worked on them. So our cells, well, we move, and our cells move within our body. Plant cells do not move, and their cells have a wall around them. And so what that means is that plant cells never move next to each other. So whoever you're born next to, you are stuck next to that cell for your entire life. What's really convenient, though, is that we can use that as a way of telling who's related to whom. So I showed you a movie where we looked in the beginning, these are all stem cells, now some of them have divided and moved on. But we can kind of go backwards. We can look at how things happen the other way. So not only can we do this in movies, but because cells are locked in next to their neighbors, we can actually, in a single image, see who was related to whom. So here we have a stem cell, because it's green. This is its sister. So it just divided from this one, left this one over. These two, though, were originally sisters with this one, and these two with this one, and so on. So you can actually get an entire history of what this cell was, because they're all locked next to each other. That doesn't happen in us. If you have stem cells in your blood marrow, those cells go off all over the body. We can't find them anymore. So this is a really convenient way of taking account of where the products of a stem cell division are. So we can watch programming, so we can watch how something becomes a stem cell and goes forward in development. And at the end, I'll show you how it's useful to watch something go backwards. All right, so I've introduced these stem cells. So what good are they? What can we learn from them? So I think one of the things that I'm quite interested in, I can describe these stem cells, you can watch them, but what are the genes that make these stem cells? What makes something a stem cell or not a stem cell? How do they know how many times to divide? And when we get to the end, since I told you could stick a plant in some water and regrow all the other cells, why do plant cells decide to stay a specialized cell? Why don't they all just revert back to stem cells and everyone go chaotic? All right, so what's the answer to this? So I've shown you this movie. This is the same cartoon. I took away some of the complexity and just left a little arrow there. So we have those asymmetric stem cell divisions and a bunch in the middle here, and then differentiation. And those things that you saw bouncing around, the green and the blue, those were particular proteins, and they're transcription factors. So the role of those proteins is to go in the nucleus of the cell, sit on DNA, and turn on or turn off other genes. So these genes are called speechless and mute. And I should explain something. So does anyone know what the term stomata means? Any Greek scholars? Mouths, yes. Yeah, so stomata is the Greek term for mouths. And a number of years ago, someone had the bright idea to start naming cutesy names, too many mouths and other things for mutants that had problems with stomata. So speechless, you might guess, has no mouths. Mute has no mouths. I apologize. Okay. There's another gene called FAMA. If you guys know what this one is, tell me after the talk, because this one's pretty impressive. Okay, so we've got these three genes, and what's cool about them is they have a very specific time and place where they act. So speechless control turns on in those stem cells, and it makes the stem cells work. Mute turns on later, and FAMA turns on at the end. Now, they don't work together. They've got partners, and those partners are called SCREAM1 and SCREAM2. Yeah, sorry. So what are these things? So we call these master regulators. So what does that mean in a developmental sense? So a master regulator is something where you have a single gene and it controls a whole lot of other things. So these are master regulators because for the time when they work, they really control that whole process. So speechless, for example, without speechless, no cell is allowed to become a stem cell. So none of them can undergo that stem cell-like asymmetric division. And the entire surface of the plant is just those pavement cells, those white cells. None of them get to become stomata. So this, of course, it's the end of the life for this plant. Without breathing, it's dead. So it's a master regulator this way. Another thing about a master regulator is, so this is what happens if you don't have it. If you turn it on too much, it should make too many stomata. And that's exactly what happens when you turn on one of these later ones. Now you get an entire surface full of mouths. Okay, so they're pretty strong controllers of this. We also call them master regulators, kind of in reference to some other master regulators that are known from animals. So these are a particular set of genes. They work in a particular way. They have a particular set of partners. And this whole system is basically the same as the things that make muscle or the things that make neurons. And in each of these cases, we have a situation where there's a cell, it needs to divide a number of times to amplify it, and then differentiate. And even though plants and animals never had any reason to share anything, they still came up with the same way of doing this. So this is pretty remarkable. It seems like this is a great way of building types of cells that involve stem cells. All right, so was fairly interesting to us that we have these genes from plants. They do things similar to animals. Obviously, we're not making neurons in plants. But three genes are not all you need to make anything. So this plant has 30,000 genes. We have 30,000 genes. We'd like to know what a few of the other genes are doing. But this is a really nice system to look at them. So we can start to ask, what genes do these turn on and turn off? And what genes do these are in these cells, because this one is marking a particular stem cell, and this one is only turned on in a later cell. And so we can do a trick where we actually isolate those cells from the plant and ask which genes have they turned on or turned off to become a stem cell, and which ones have they turned on or turned off to become something later. So we can use this as a way of figuring out what's happening in each of these cell types. And we use a trick called fluorescence-activated cell sorting. So one of the things is these are cells within a developing organism. There are not very many of them. So how do you find something that's one in a million? And the trick is that you use an invention from this guy. This is Len Herzenberg. He's a wonderful, he died recently, but he's a wonderful inventor of this machine. He was an immunologist, and he wanted to find very rare cells. So he invented a way of sorting out individual cells from a big population. And he's actually wearing a t-shirt that shows you how this works. You can't really see it, so I won't give you the details about how all the lasers work. But essentially, what we're going to do in our system is we have an intact plant. And this is important. Everything's working normally. We're going to loosen up the walls around the cell so we can pop them out. And put them into a beaker for a little while, and then we can flow them through this FACS sorter, and this FACS sorter is just going to select the ones that are glowing. So in the case of what you saw in that movie, just the green cells or just the blue cells. And then we're going to figure out what's in those cells, and the way that we figure out whether a gene is turned on or turned off is that we measure RNA, okay, in a couple of different ways. So we're going to be able to detect what does this cell think it's doing, which genes has it turned on or off. Okay, so I'm going to now orient you this way from the earliest to the latest. It's the same diagram. I only have one diagram. I just use it a lot. Okay, so what changes? All right, and I'm going to walk you through this. So when we look at what happens here, there are a lot of genes that change at this stage or are unique to this stage, and a lot to here and a lot to here. And the way that we represent this is with one of these heat maps. So on here are thousands of different lines. Each one of those represents a different gene. If it's red, it means that at this time, the gene's really way up. Everywhere else, it's down. So here's a set of genes that at this early stage, all of these genes are turned on, but then they're turned off for the rest of the development. Here's a set that are turned on just at this stage and not earlier. Okay, so we can get a sense of who's turned on when and where. Okay, and I will not advance, apparently. Okay. Technical difficulties. I may actually need serious help with this. Okay, we're gonna do the hard start here, okay? You are stuck with this forever. Okay. Let's see what we got now. We have a blank screen. Oh. Okay, yes. Please just observe the universe while I work on this. The great thing is I teach undergraduates, and when you have 300 of them staring at you because you're doing something stupid, after a while you stop caring. Okay, where's our magical tech people? Da-da-da. They're just totally frozen out.
He's coming down.
Okay. All right, the most amazing movie you've ever seen is happening on my screen. Anything you want to see is on there.
Did it freeze?
I think it's, well,
it froze.
Yeah. Tell me what to do.
Try this.
Okay. Yep. You can restart. Okay, what can I talk about while we're waiting? Any questions so far? Nope, okay. Darn, thought I would get a head start on them. I hear there's a lot of questions.
What's the story with Fama?
What's the story with Fama? So does anyone know who Fama is?
It means fame in Spanish.
Yeah? Yep, okay, so fame in Spanish, it's on the right track. It's related to speech. So Fama is a goddess, and she's the goddess of rumor. And so what I didn't show you is if you don't have Fama, what happens is, so you need Fama to make the two guard cells that make the stoma. If you don't have Fama, something gets stopped earlier and you make this tumor that spreads across. So it's a spreading rumor. Okay, anyone else? Might be time for that new computer upgrade. Okay, so where were we? We talked about Fama.
We had a question.
Yeah. Okay, so you're talking about this petri dish of the iPS cells that was determining what they were? So in those cells, so this is in human cells, and here's something where you take a cell and you reprogram it into something else. And so this is really, really rapidly changing field. So I might be 6 months out of date, which means I'm hopelessly out of date. But it does seem that you need some ways of, well, first, people thought you needed to deprogram. So you were something, now you need to go back to zero and start again. That was the idea for a while. That turned out to not be true. You can go directly from one to another. So the factors include a bunch of things that help these cells sort of reset themselves, but also specific factors that tell them, this is a gene that tells you you should be a neuron. So the environment there is kind of a collection of things that you've, genes that you've put in there, rather than an environment meaning like it was hot or cold. Yeah.
Does this usually do that?
Never happened before. Okay. So close.
You remember which? You remember which slide? You remember.
Right. Stay here by my side while I find my slide. Okay. Okay, this is where we left off, right? Yeah, thank you. Okay, don't leave. Okay, good. All right. So what are these things? So we have lots of genes that change, and these were these major master regulators. So we're finding among them there's these targets. But what are these genes? So at the end, when we're trying to make this specialized cell type, this thing that can open and close, okay. Matt, what did you do? okay,
So this is about stomata. So we found some things that we kind of expected, genes that are involved in the function of these cells, so that was good. But what about the stem cell part? And one of the things that we noticed, so if you look at these, about 1,000 genes, about 10,000 genes. So when cells are being chosen to become stem cells, they're massively changing everything. So whatever they were before, they are erasing that, and they are starting on some new trajectory. What was interesting was that this is a meristemoid. This is only making one type of cell. So we compared the reprogramming here to these other meristems, the ones that can make lots of different cell types. And they all undergo massive programming, but they're actually all different. And so there's not a fundamental, this is a stem cell. Every stem cell has its own specific set of things that it needs. The other thing that we noticed is here we have massive reprogramming. And then there's something called chromatin remodeling. So DNA in the cell needs, so how you get genes turned on and off, but it's wrapped up in a particular way. It's wrapped up in a way that can be open and lots of genes can be accessed or can be closed. And what we're seeing here is that you have lots of things that are changing, and then the cell changes its DNA in a big structural way to kind of lock things in. All right, so this is kind of a big overview, and I'm not going to go into the details of all the little things that we found, although personally I'm totally fascinated by them. But we're interested in these. Well, one of the things that came up when we were thinking about this is that we had, in order to do this technically, we had to isolate a couple thousand cells. And when you do that, you kind of average everything together. But we started thinking about this and saying we had everything that was sort of a green cell and everything that was a blue cell. But what about that decision in between? And this is a big question in developmental biology. First it was green, then it was blue. What actually happens as you make that transition from being a stem cell to not? Is it one gene that changes? Is it a gradual transition? And so what we're doing now that the technology has gotten better is that we're looking at individual cells that we can sort out and asking what genes have you turned, you specific cell, what genes have you turned on and what genes have the other ones turned on? And what we're trying to figure out is when you go from being green to blue, are we gonna see cells that are very slowly and gradually changing their genes in such a way that we see lots of different intermediate steps and everyone goes through the same steps? Or are we gonna see something where you're green for a while and then massively all of a sudden everything changes? We don't know how they make that transition. And that's something that we, working in plants and people working in animals, are really interested in how you make those snap decisions. All right, so there's lots of stuff in the middle, but actually what I wanna talk about here is something at the end. And this was a surprise to us. And first we thought all the exciting stuff was happening here. This is making a stem cell. This is being a stem cell. This is just sort of finishing the job. But it turned out this was actually pretty interesting. So how do you decide I am going to be a stomatal guard cell for the rest of my life? And really surprisingly, the answer had something to do with a tumor protein from a tumor suppressor from animals. And this is called retinoblastoma. So retinoblastoma, this is actually the eye disease, so it's a cancer of the eye. You can see here the retina reflects light differently. So this is someone who has retinoblastoma in one eye and this is a normal eye. It's something that's usually diagnosed in children. So retinoblastoma became very famous for this. It's actually a protein that's on in all of our cells, and it's helping to regulate them so that they don't grow out of control and into a tumor. So retinoblastoma, or it's called RB in humans and RBR in plants, this is normally something that helps prevent tumors. And it does this by clamping down and telling cells, you should actually stop dividing. So in a way, it's kind of an anti-stem cell gene. It binds to these chromatin modifiers, so it can move DNA around. And there was an idea that it could lock cells into a permanent fate, but this was not really very clear from the kind of experiments that were being done. One of the difficulties is in humans and in mice, there are actually several copies of this gene, so we didn't really know what it was doing. And of course, this is, if you completely get rid of it, then no organism can live. So all organisms need to have this retinoblastoma protein working well enough to actually develop. So we found, very surprisingly, that Fama here, this goddess of rumor, actually bound to the plant version of retinoblastoma. And this was something, so these are a particular type of transcription factor. They're very closely related to one another. These two don't bind, but this one does. So something special about this protein. And we thought these kind of features were kind of interesting. So this is at the end of this division. We're out of stem cell division, so we're stopping here. We want to lock into this fate. So maybe Fama and this protein work together. So, but then we were stuck in this conundrum. We can't get rid of RBR because cells will die. We can't get rid of Fama because if we get rid of Fama, we can't make these guard cells. And if we can't make guard cells, we can't breathe and we die. So we couldn't get rid of either one of those. But we could find a single amino acid in that protein, a single bit of that protein that we could mutate so that these two could still do their normal jobs. They just couldn't do whatever they did together. So here's a version where this one can still bind DNA and still turn on genes. This can still do lots of things, but they can't work together anymore. And we wondered what happened then. All right, so I'm going to show you what happens then. So first thing is we have these two proteins. We get a plant out of it, so things are working well enough that both our Fama that doesn't bind to RBR and RBR, they're okay. But then we notice something weird. Okay, so now you guys are all experts here, so you know purple means guard cells. So this is what you see. Okay, so take a look at that. So you see purple stomata, right? And then you see stomata inside of stomata. And then sometimes you see stomata inside of stomata, inside of stomata, inside of stomata. So this is not normal. Normally we don't make little mini stomata inside of stomata. What we're seeing, because again, plant cells can't move, they're locked in place, what we're seeing is the final product, these guard cells, being reprogrammed and them going back to the beginning and trying to generate a new stomata, but there already is one, so they get trapped inside. So this is kind of remarkable. We're actually able to look in an intact organism at reprogramming, at going backwards. So are they going backwards? Yep. So those green stem cell genes that turn on, those are normally turned off at this point. They turn back on. The next one turns back on. So we're actually kind of going backwards here. So then we wondered, how far back are we going? So we started here. We started here, and now that we can't get locked in this fate, we know we get back this far, but do we go back to becoming a meristem or an embryo or a fertilized egg? How far back are we stopping? So this is data showing, so we're monitoring all these genes as a shortcut way of saying, when you see a bar go up, that means that back in here, genes got turned on that are normally on earlier in life. So all of these genes that were in this part of the pathway get turned on. But when we look at markers of genes that represent something that thinks it's a meristem or something that thinks it's an embryo, none of those got turned on. So what's happening here is that these cells are going backwards, but they're not going all the way back. They're not becoming babies again or embryos. They're just going back to the beginning of this lineage. And so we have this situation here where essentially we're massively reprogramming something to be a stem cell with one type of transcription factor. We're letting it go through the pathway, we're getting to the end, and we're locking things down with a different, a very similar transcription factor with a different partner. So the way that we think about this is that we've got this system here where the way that you have a stem cell be born and go through its life and end is that you use transcription factors that are very similar to one another. One of them opens the door, lets you go ahead and do this. And then the one at the end, make sure that you slam the door at the end and you can never go back. So what do we get out of all of this? And I think we're a little late on time for my technical difficulties, but I'll go through this. So I find this remarkable. Plants and animals have no reason to be using the same genes unless there's something about the way that those genes interact that is really good for making stem cells. And that seems to be the case here. So that's something that I think we could take out. The other thing that's really, I think, one of the super cool things about plants is that because everything that you're seeing here is out there, it's for you to look at, cells are locked in place. We have this beautiful way of looking as the organism develops at something becoming a stem cell and going through all those stem cell divisions and leaving that, or in the case of reprogramming, going backwards. And we don't really have another way of doing that. We can look at things in a dish, but we don't have that real in situ behavior. But for my big question, I said there's a lot of similarities between how animals and plants do their stem cells, but we still don't know exactly why the plant cells are so good, why they're so much better than ours. But I think when I showed you that diagram before of saying, well, what does it mean when things solve things the same way? I think what it means is that if we think about how the potential of our stem cells versus plant stem cells, it's going to be about tuning. It's going to be about little subtle things that are different between the two that makes plant stem cells a bit better at renewing themselves than animal ones. And we can figure out that tuning, maybe we can improve ours. All right, totally switching gears. Before, this was the end product, okay? So these are those two guard cells, and everything that I talked about was about making them, and once they were there, we didn't really care about them, because this was a model for trying to understand how stem cells worked. But plant stem cells actually matter, and the final product of these actually matters a lot. And so this became a little bit famous or infamous about 10 years ago, where it was argued that stomata are the most influential cell type on the planet. And you know, you might argue that human brain cells are a fairly influential cell type, but you know, we can't live without these, and plants can probably live without our brain cells. So this is probably one of the most influential cells on the planet because of its function, because of this function in taking in carbon dioxide and releasing water vapor. And so this was so not to be outdone 10 years ago. Now it is not only arguably the most influential cell on the planet, but at the center of a crisis in water availability and crop production that we expect to see over the next few decades. All right, so just a reminder of why we care about these. So this is that portal from which carbon dioxide enters from the atmosphere into the plant. It gets fixed into sugars. We eat that. Water vapor and oxygen come out. So plants absolutely are dependent on this. It helps them get the carbon dioxide. It also helps them bring water. So plants don't have a vascular system. They can't pump things around. They actually have to evapotranspirate. So water is in the soil, comes up through the plant, and by evaporating at the top, that brings the water up. It also helps to keep the plant cool, like sweating. Okay, so you're going to watch this loop a couple times. I'll explain what it is in a moment. But that's what one plant's stomata does. It's really important for that one plant. But if you start to think about all of the stomata, so there's millions of stomata on each plant, and there are millions of plants, and there's millions of acres. If you start thinking about the activity of all of those stomata, they're actually driving our climate cycles. So if you think about imagine the entire water content of the atmosphere. That's being recycled through stomata twice a year. 30% of the carbon that's in the atmosphere is coming in through stomata. So they have a massive effect on the climate. And so this thing that you've been watching in yellow is actually CO2, and in green is vegetation. And so as this loops around, oh, talk too long, had that timed like this. Oh, maybe we won't go back ever. Don't do this to me. Okay, we're back. So what we're watching is how over the course of a year carbon dioxide changes. So we're going to wait until winter time. So northern hemisphere, we start heating. We start creating CO2 in the atmosphere. It takes over. Then green. Springtime, greening, plants suck it all back up. And you're going to see this happening over and over again. So it grows in the winter time. We get lots of it. Then you start to see greening up here, greening up in Canada. And then they take, those plants are taking all of that carbon dioxide back in. So they're basically making this planet breathe. I find this a really fun movie to watch. Okay, so Those individual stomata that I just said, well, they're the byproduct of the stem cell, they're driving this. But the interesting thing is, there's an interlink between these. So stomata, their function is driving what the global climate is doing. But at the same time, plants are thinking about thinking. Plants are taking in information about what the climate is doing, and they're actually changing themselves, and they're changing the activity of those stem cells that I just told you about. So it's going back and forth and back and forth, and this becomes incredibly important when we start to think about what the future will hold. So this is an example of some of the ways that plants are taking in information. So things like carbon dioxide and temperature and light, when we think about climate change, those sorts of things that are variable, plants are responding to that. So on one hand, if you think about high CO2 might be good for plants. That's food. So CO2 can come in. That would be great. These stomata, maybe you don't need to make as many because plenty of carbon dioxide is there, and so you don't lose as much water. And that seems like a good idea. You don't wilt, you get lots of food. So, in fact, that's kind of what happens. When you have different levels of carbon dioxide, you make smaller stomata at higher levels, you make slightly different things. In light, this is coffee, by the way, so very important thing. So shade-grown coffee doesn't have very many stomata. Full sun coffee has a lot of them. So plants are sampling what the environment is doing, and they're changing themselves. But by them changing themselves, they're changing what the climate is doing. And so you could end up in this, my colleague Joe Barry at Carnegie's Global Ecology Department calls this the stomatal death spiral, where what do we expect in climate change? So high CO2, high temperature. So high CO2, plants say, great, high CO2, I don't need as many stomata, or I can make smaller ones, so I don't lose as much water. So they don't breathe as much. Not only is water coming out there for the sense of moving it around the plant, but it helps cool the plant. So now you have a plant that doesn't want to breathe as much, but then it doesn't sweat as much. And so what happens? It overheats and dies. So we get into these cycles where stomata are both contributing to and responding to the environment. And this is something that we need to put into our models. And so it was really actually very gratifying that about a week ago, this came out. This is Science Magazine in this beautiful Amazonian tropics. And what they were trying to do was they were trying to explain why the models that they had about how climate cycles were working in the Amazon, why they weren't exactly correct. And what they figured out was that they had to take into account not only stomata, but the fact that new leaves were being developed. And you've seen how the way that you make stomata makes all of these cells in the leaf. So there's a connection between the stem cells in the leaf and the photosynthesis in here. So all of this stuff that I went through very briefly here about these stem cells is actually helping the plant adapt to those environments. And so what we're trying to do with, in combination with some colleagues over in global ecology as well as elsewhere, is figure out what those links are so we can talk about molecules like speechless that actually can take in that information about the environment, process it, and give us an answer for the plant. All right, so we got to the end. Whew. Nothing broke down yet. So this is the current lab, very, very productive lab. And apparently my lab is also live streaming and drinking every time I say the word stem cell, so I think by now in California, I'm looking at the cameras, I'm thinking that they're under the table. But some of the work I wanted to just highlight a couple people's work that I talked about. Those movies you saw were made by Kelly. Jessica did the fax sorting to get all those different cell types. Juliana and Charles did that retinoblastoma experiment. And Graham and Joe were the people who were working on the global ecology of this. So I would be, and these folks gave us a lot of support and a lot of money, and this is really wonderful. We're very privileged to be able to do this, and we're very privileged to be next to two Carnegie departments, one of which does molecular biology very much like me, and one of which does global ecology, and they're both really great collaborations. So thank you so much for sticking through all my technical difficulties and getting to the end. I appreciate it.
And overreacting to some recent political events. I did a broad brush slur of politicians, which is not what I believe and not what, and it was quite unfair. And I would like to apologize for that. I think there are plenty of people who are leaders and in government who really are trying to make our lives better and the world, lives around the world much better. And I should watch it when I'm joking around like that. So, okay, let's go to questions. We have one over here.
Alien stem cell and plant stem cells, but plants didn't get cancer, and I was hoping you were going to elaborate on that.
Yeah, okay, so why is it that, so there's this balance in mammalia, we worry about this, that stem cells can be too good, and they can lead to cancer if, and there's also ideas of cancer stem cells, so why don't plants get cancer? And that is still entirely. They have figured out some other sort of surveillance that is still a mystery to us. And I really hope that we do understand it, but right now it's still this sort of tuning that we don't quite get.
My question was very much in the same vein. You mentioned that FAMA, when it's knocked out, mm-hmm. You do see tumor growth, but it just doesn't ever break in nature and wild type? You don't ever see...
that's a good question. So when we talk about genes that are related to tumors, we have individuals who have a broken version of that and then they get a tumor. So I think the thing is that in nature, we're not, I mean, we care a lot about each individual person. And so we're, you know, someone who has a genetic defect that they get a little bit later in life, we identify them. So there probably are plants that have defects in this, but they've just sort of died alone out in the wilderness and we haven't found them. So I think that's really the answer. It probably would be very detrimental to them, but we're just not observing them. Yeah.
So I have to credit my sister, the molecular biologist, for helping me be able to ask the following question.
Okay.
I wouldn't have figured this out on my own. But what she's taught me is the concept of something that's evolutionarily conserved. So how similar is RBR and RB? And if so, what have the, I guess, microbial evolutionary biologists learned about that that could explain that?
Okay, so RB, this tumor suppressor, and RBR, they're pretty similar proteins, but so what do these proteins do? It turns out that these proteins are kind of a, some call them like a dating service. So what they do is they bring other things together, right? And what they bring together in plant cells might be different than what they bring together in animal cells. So they are pretty similar. In animals, what's happened is that we have two other copies of it. So it seems to be important enough in animals that we make some duplicate ones, which makes the role of each one a little bit harder to figure out. In terms of microbes, you know, I don't think there's an RB in microbes. So I don't think there's any evidence that single cell. So if you think about a single-celled organism, cancer for a single-celled organism is like a bonanza. So it's like lots of you, right? So they might have a very different appreciation of what cancer means and wanting to have a tumor suppressor if you're only one cell.
So basically then it's maybe just like some sort of basic kind of tool, piece of machinery. I mean, my question is, you talked about an evolutionary tree mm-hmm. where the branch is very early on. Mm-hmm. If I understand what you're saying about RB, it doesn't go back before the branch. It maybe appears somewhere near the point of branching
right.
and
so that,
has been repurposed, but not maybe that much.
Yeah. So the RB is found in some unicellular algae. So I should take that back. Some unicellular things care about their cell cycle control. So RB is not really the thing that I would have, that's possible that one thing was inherited. What I think is really striking is not only inheriting one gene, but a network of genes working together. And so in stomata and in neurons, it's not that you have just one of the same genes, but you have several of them that work one after the other, and they all share the same partners. And there's lots of other things about it that's not just having one individual thing, but keeping the connections between the things. That's really remarkable. Why would you rebuild the same connections? And so that's what we find interesting about the plants and animals here. In terms of RB, RB having a partner with one of these, it's first found in plants. We should actually go back and see if it's true in animals. We actually don't know the answer to that. So we lead. Always good to be plant first.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
From what I understood from your method of studying stomata development, you're using cotyledons, which are ultimately embryonic tissues.
Mm-hmm.
Do the mechanisms that you see translate to vegetative tissues like true leaves and stomata that develop on stems?
Okay, so you are an aficionado. So actually, so this is a very good point. When I showed the pictures of the embryos and there were those two little leaves, those were the embryonic leaves called cotyledons, and they make stomata. But every leaf that's born after that also makes this idea of tuning about study the things that I was talking about here. We study those in the true leaves because the true leaves are actually growing and making those. So in that case, it's happening in both things.
Thank you very much. It's fascinating. I have a general question. Would you advise, based on where you are, to include your research, simplified, and to integrate it in libraries, in particular schools, and to make it available to not higher than high school level,
mm-hmm.
To motivate, to inspire? Specifically, now, second step is, we are told that only 20% of flora and fauna has been discovered. So it's a lot to discover. Would you use your research to give some indication how to organize and to accelerate the process of discovery of more flora and fauna? I hope it makes sense.
Yeah, so I think there are a number of different questions in here. So one is, how do we get people to know and appreciate plants early on? How many of you actually had plant biology in high school? Wow, I did not. I actually had to go and read a textbook in a corner by myself to get anything about plants, so it was not part of my curriculum. So I think introducing some of the stuff and anything here that's of interest would definitely be part of it. Now, in terms of this discovery of what's out there in nature, we've really focused on a couple of plants and tried to figure out the details of those individual plants. But I think this idea of going out and looking at, I kind of mentioned this, going out and seeing the ways that nature has solved some of these fundamental questions in different ways, I think that would be absolutely fascinating. And I think, maybe the Carnegie should have some trips to exotic places and collect some exotic plants.
I think that's an excellent idea. It's pretty clear, though, that we should take a substantial part of this audience with us because of the level of expertise and the quality of the questions.
Thank you. Full disclosure, I'm a member of the UNESCO task force, and we intend to see how we can accelerate, possibly, to motivate, to inspire the young generation to learn about nature in a more structured way. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. And just to mention, we have a wonderful Carnegie Academy of Science Education where students work downstairs in this building, getting the experience of discovery. And so we're very much on board with your goals. Well, I guess that brings us to the end of the questions. We'll thank Dominique again for a wonderful session.